Howdy, partners, edgers, villagers, chatters, and friends. Welcome to the Haunted Chronicles episode 217. Our father who are in... Jennifer.
Heaven.
Correct, right, thank you. Tonight, we're going to talk about a whole bunch of strange, odd, and bizarre deaths. And tonight's episode is sponsored by... Sergio Valente Jeans. And now a word from our sponsor.
Available at Abraham and Strauss.
Wait, and thank you, Sergio Valente. And check out warrens.net. There's a whole bunch of events leading up to Halloween that you can attend on warrens.net. I am Mr. Haunted, joined by RH Negative, Alien Blooded, Ghost Bustin', co-host Jennifer Baby Soft, Jigglypuff Runyon. Jennifer!
Jimmy!
Jennifer, where have you been?
I have no idea. Drugged. I swear I've been drugged and left on a couch to heal. No, I'm good. I'm so sorry I missed last week. I just was really in a lot of pain with a back injury, but I'm good. All good now.
All better.
Yes.
So, you know what I did last week?
Tell me.
I went to a freaking UFO convention.
I know. Can you tell us about it?
Well, I didn't know what to expect, but this the lady Susan that we had on a couple weeks ago, she it was so nice. She put us in a nice room. We had like free food, and we got a vendor table, and there was a food truck that was there the whole day. Like you could just go there and eat stuff for free, and have cold beverages, and we I spoke on stage in front of people.
Aww.
Oh my goodness gracious.
This is so awesome, and you did great.
I did all right, I think.
Yeah, I think you did good. I think you did good, buddy.
And what else?
Crazy, right? Yeah.
And before I forget, I was so you know I'm trying to promote the book, and our publicist wants us to do all these guest interviews and stuff.
Exactly.
And, and I've been like, I literally did about 10 in the last 2 weeks, and like they're 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock at night, and then I have to get up at 2 a.m. in the morning, so I'm really dead. But I wanted to remind everyone, we're gonna be at Whitley Strieber's Dreamland show on Halloween. We're at a Halloween show.
That is
Whitley Strieber.
So cool. That is so cool, Whitley Strieber. I love this. I am tuning in.
Holy mackerel!
I cannot wait to hear that. That's gonna be fun.
Fun. Yeah. So.
Yeah. So, Jimmy.
Yeah.
How you been doing?
Funny you should ask.
Yeah.
Because today, I'm happier than a Mercury Island tusked Weta flipping some freaking flapjacks in his little copper frying pan whilst humming the theme to Three's Company like his freaking Michael Bublé.
But what is this thing?
It's a kind of beetle. It's a tusked Weta.
It's a tusked Weta.
Yeah, it's like those, you know, those bugs with those big like claws.
Oh yeah, with the little clinchers. Like the big, they look like
Yeah, he's like, it looks like a monster, but it's tiny.
Oh, oh, oh. Would I be scared of it if I saw it?
To death.
Yeah,
dead,
thanks.
Dead.
Dead.
Yeah, we'll do a lot of those later, I think. You know, Jennifer?
Yes.
School's back. I'm behind a lot of buses lately, the school buses.
Yes.
And guess what? And all of a sudden, I saw two school bus stories this week.
Ooh.
So I have some breaking news to share with you. Breaking news! The first one, this just happened September 21st in Indiana. Mm-hmm. So this lady, Joandria McAtee, 27, she was arrested after students filmed her allowing kids to drive her school bus.
Oh my God, no!
So listen to this. She allowed three students. You know that's wrong, right? You should know that.
Is that fake?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now listen to the ages. Mm-hmm. One was 17.
Okay.
She let them drive the school bus for short distances. Mm-hmm. 13-year-old.
Oh.
And a little wee 11-year-old.
Oh, my God.
And I said, and there were other students on the bus at the time. It's not, you know, like they were alone.
Yeah. What was this person thinking?
And they got arrested for some kind of felony, child endangerment charge.
Yes. That's bad.
And she was fired. But guess what?
What?
I can top it.
Okay.
On October 1st.
Yeah. Now,
the first one was from Indiana, and this one was from India. So I really think I'm in the Truman Show, and people just make events up. This just happened in India on October 1st. Uh-huh. A bus driver, his name is Prakash.
Prakash.
He allowed a little partner to help him drive the bus. And he's a driver.
Yeah. So
a langur monkey, said to belong to a passenger, hopped into the driver's seat and refused to budge. So the driver then encouraged the little monkey, and he sat him on his lap and even chuckled as the monkey steered the bus. You picture the scene, see?
Okay.
So remember, remember a few years ago was Year of the Monkey in the and we had all monkey stories. Was so
oh hot. Yeah, we were so into monkeys. They were so hot at that time.
So,
yeah.
So the driver sat him on his lap, and he was even chuckling as the monkey steered with his grip on the correct 10-2 positions. And guess what?
What?
So Prakash guy was immediately removed from his job pending an investigation. But unlike the lady in Indiana, he might get suspended.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
More accepted in India, apparently.
I think it is, you know. I mean, they probably like, you know, let's give the monkey a pass. Come on. The little monkey. Oh, I bet he was so proud of himself. I get to see the little gentleman sitting there.
Little gentleman.
Oh, yeah.
Langur monkey.
Little langur monkey.
And of course, in our friends' page, they're sharing pictures of monkeys. And okay. So we have some celebrity birthdays for you before we get to our terrible, tragic deaths.
Oh, my God.
Oh,
yes.
My God.
Ugh.
So this week, we have our friend Suzanne Summers.
Oh.
She's born on October 16th, and she's known for 1973's American Graffiti, the TV series She's the Sheriff, and was Chrissy Snow in Three's Company.
Yes.
How old is Chrissy Snow going to be this week?
You know, I don't know, but the only reason I'm going to say this age is because I think I saw that everyone's so amazed how good she looks for her age. So I'm going to say 71.
She'll be 72, correct?
So that, honestly, that woman, she looks amazing.
I can't believe it. And she liked my comment once.
You told me about that.
You remember
that's
that.
Pretty, I, of course I do.
That's, I think that's second to my my Henry Winkler retweeted me.
Oh, that was that was epic.
There's nothing that could beat that, really.
Oh, no.
Okay. Angela Lansbury, who is your co-star, I think.
Yeah, twice. I worked with her twice. Mm-hmm. Well, okay, Angela.
She's still making movies. Mm-hmm. She has one that's coming out soon. And her first role was in 1944's Gaslight. Mm-hmm. Well, she's probably best known as her role as Jessica Fletcher in the TV series that Jennifer starred in, along with her. Murder, she wrote.
Well, just two episodes. Just two. Okay, Angela Lansbury, Jimmy. I know she's up there and an incredible force of nature. And she is 91.
Wow, she's going to be 93. I think that's a correct two.
Oh, that's not bad. I was pretty close.
Yeah, that's very good. Somebody's way up there like that.
Woohoo!
So, let's see. Do I have one more? I think I do.
All right.
Cliff Richard.
Oh.
When I was a kid, he was all over the radio. And he was a singer who was once known as Britain's answer to Elvis Presley. And he had 100 hit singles in the UK. And we're going to hear one of his songs at the break. And it's one of the songs that I always, it's on my Halloween playlist every year.
Which one is it?
Devil Woman by Cliff
Richard. Oh, yeah. That was a good song, yeah.
So, how old's little Cliff Richard next week?
Well, why don't we go the route of 72?
He's going to be 78 years old.
Oh, wow. God, all of our rockers. All of our rockers,
thank you
know?
You.
It's crazy.
Yeah. And as I'm looking for the celebrity birthdays, all the people we normally do are like dying off, and I'm searching so hard to find anybody that we even recognize. I don't know who these people are.
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, isn't there... There's all these celebrities now that you're like, who is this?
Yeah, I don't know them.
I know. I don't know them either. I got to start getting educated on that, though.
Anyways, I was scouring the internet this week for bizarre deaths.
Mm-hmm.
And man, there's some crazy ones.
Oh, boy, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I did just find them going all the way back to, like, you know,
1100, I think.
Antiquity, yes. Antiquity times Middle Ages.
I bet we have the same one, because one of them cracks me up. I don't know why.
Okay.
Well, okay, I got to find it.
Are you going to get it, or do you want me to start with one?
You could start. You start.
Ooh, okay. I'm going to start with this one, because it was so... What?
Did you just moo?
No.
All right. I heard a moo.
It wasn't me.
It wasn't like that.
Wasn't that.
Okay. Really? I'm going to show you later. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Okay. This is horrible. I don't know who this is. This is Edmund Ironside.
Okay.
Okay, this is back in the Middle Ages. And Edmund Ironside, he found his untimely death by being stabbed while he was sitting on the toilet by an assassin hiding underneath. Ouch.
What happened?
He was stabbed whilst. It says Edmund Ironside was stabbed whilst on a toilet by an assassin hiding underneath.
Wow.
Ouch.
Don't get any ideas, people.
Ouch.
He just needed some privacy and he got stabbed.
I have another one.
Yeah.
Okay. This is Crown Prince Philippe of France. This is sad. This is so sad. Crown Prince Philip of France died while riding through Paris when his horse tripped over a black pig running out of a dung heap.
Wow, you know, it's so funny, their details. It was a black pig.
It was a black pig. Oh,
my God, that's crazy.
I know.
I saw a lot of historical ones.
Okay.
But I found a recent, kind of recent one.
Okay.
This is a true story.
Okay.
All right, this happened October of 2010 in the Congo, wherever the Congo is.
Uh-huh.
So if anybody knows where the Congo is, let me know. Thank you.
Yeah. Somewhere in Africa.
I think so. Yeah. So this small plane crashed into a house just hundreds of feet from its destination. It was almost there, but no, it didn't make it. It killed the pilot and 19 others.
Oh.
And they tried to figure out what happened. There was no mechanical problems were found or reported. And so one of the passengers thought it would be a swell idea to put a freaking crocodile in a big duffel bag, which he planned to sell afterwards, in the plane.
Oh, my God.
So it was discovered that later they found out that the crocodile escaped and caused panic and a stampede of the passengers towards the cabin, threw it off balance, crashed. And the lone survivor relayed this bizarre tale to the investigators. And the crocodile and that one survivor are the only people that survived the crash.
Where was this again?
In the Congo.
Oh, my God. I don't know that's crazy.
Idaho or, you know.
Yeah. We got some Congo potatoes that grow there in Idaho.
No, it's just a sad ending to the story. You know, this crocodile did nothing wrong, right?
No.
Did nothing wrong.
Oh, no.
They let him have it, apparently.
Well, he... What? Oh, my God.
This crocodile survived a hunter with a duffel bag.
Yes!
Plane crashed, then they chopped him up.
Okay, all right. We're gonna get rid of the animal ones right now because I don't even want to do these two that are about.
Well, save them for later in case we need we'll get a little refresher before that because
these two are pretty sad and I don't even want to repeat them, but I do have another airplane story.
Oh. Tell.
Okay. This is in the 1990s, 1991. A male flight instructor and a female student, Carl Buford and Terry and Linda Vanier Keith, were killed when the Piper PA-34 Seneca plane they were flying crashed. It is believed it was caused by the two people having sex in the cockpit of the plane. Movements in the cockpit led to the stick being pushed down.
You know I'm laughing. Okay. It's the area where the pilot sits.
It's where the pilot sits. Anyway, it made the... When they pushed down on that little sticky thing, I guess the plane just... It exceeded its speed limitations and it broke off the right wing.
Oh, my God. These people.
Why would you even... I'm sorry. If I am learning how to fly a plane, the last thing I'm going to be thinking about, I'm going to be thinking about my life and making sure I know what's happening.
I always think I make stupid decisions, but after seeing people let monkeys drive their bus in the cockpit there, we're not so bad.
Yeah, right?
Doing all right.
Yeah.
I found a really, really tragic... You know, this seems like something you'd learn about in history class. Okay. Maybe you've heard of it. I haven't. Maybe you listeners have heard of it.
Okay.
I'd say this is the sweetest disaster ever.
Ooh.
Have you ever heard of the Boston molasses disaster?
Tell us.
You never heard of it?
Well, I read about it, but I don't know if anyone else has heard. But tell us, please. All right.
On January 15th of 1919... Boston suffered one of history's strangest disasters. Imagine a steel tank, an enormous steel tank, 50 feet tall by 90 feet across, it's able to hold 2.5 million gallons of molasses.
Wow.
So just afternoon this day, all hell broke loose. Witnesses recall hearing a noise like gunfire as the tank's rivets started popping and the steel sides ripped open. And suddenly, 26 million pounds of molasses were tearing down Commercial Street in a 15-foot wave. The flood claims 21 lives and 150 people were injured by the molasses.
Oh, my God. You can't swim out of molasses, man. that's like in a big pool of mud. Ooh,
that's crazy. Sucks.
That sucks. Well, I have a little story about Betty Staubs.
Oh, what happened to Betty Staubs?
Okay, Betty was 67, and she was delivering a bale of hay to her sheep. And the starving sheep, they were so hungry, they were starving, and they rushed Staubs, who was on her motorcycle. In the ensuing scuffle, Staubs was knocked down into a deep ravine near Durham, England. She survived the fall, but her motorcycle landed on her, killing her instantly.
So you're saying that she was delivering a bale of hay to the sheep on a motorcycle?
I don't quite understand that. I don't understand how you're holding a bale of hay on a motorcycle.
And they were
Betty Staubs did.
So and they were so young. Hungry that
they rushed her.
They rushed her and she
charged her. Oh, Betty.
Poor Betty Staubs.
Betty. Poor Betty.
Bless her little heart.
I know.
You know,
hey, do you? Yeah. Go. No, no, you go. You go.
Well, no, that reminded me because of the sheep. It reminded me of a wool story that I know off the top of my head.
Okay.
Well, in 1987, an owner of a wool mill had an accident on one of his machines. See, poor Paul Thomas, he was only 47 years old, was operating a pinwheel dresser machine, which winds a woolen yarn from one large spool onto a smaller one. Well, poor little Paul Thomas got wrapped in 800 yards of yarn and suffocated and died.
Oh, that is dead. So horrifying.
But, like, that got to be the, like, softest, most comfortable death that there could be.
You know, I would be breaking out in hives and itching from the wool, but yes.
So that kind of, yeah, that kind of went with your sheep story a little bit.
Yes, it did. Jimmy,
yeah.
Do you know people that are obsessive about cleanliness? I mean, overly obsessive, like.
I wish I did, Jennifer.
Well, you know, there are these people, and it's a thing. You know, I have a friend who has this, and they have to constantly wash their hands. My friend is constantly bleaching everything, you know, the counters, everything, the toilets, whatever. I mean, every day. It's crazy. Well, in 1998, 16-year-old Jonathan Capwell, he died from a heart attack. It was brought on by the buildup of butane and propane in his blood after excessive use of deodorant sprays. What? He had an obsession with cleanliness, and the autopsy showed that Capwell had an amount of butane in him that and propane that it's fatal. So this kid was putting so much deodorant on. He was probably putting it, you know, all over, I would think. I don't know how just putting that under your arms is going to kill you. But he probably was maybe a sweaty boy. He was a little sweaty boy, and he had to,
You know what that reminds me of? Yeah.
Tell me. Yeah, don't tell me.
Well, no, when you go to the mall and I see the people in the nail salons and they're all wearing those masks.
Yes.
And it's like, it must be for a reason.
Yes. And they can't like breathe that.
Everyone else is probably dying in there, and they don't even let them know.
I know. I'm always wondering when I'm getting when I'm at a salon, should I be wearing a mask right now?
Like,
Yeah, well, listen, all I'm saying about the cleanliness thing, it's good to be hygienic and everything, but my girlfriend, who doesn't listen to the show, so I can say all this, she contracted a very serious autoimmune disease because they said one of the causes is using too much bleach and cleaners and, So, be careful, people.
You know, that's weird because there's a lot of good stuff that causes, like, sickness or death. Like I wanted to do a show and it really didn't fit in. Like there's things that I actually have a story later about one of these things. But like if you know how salt, we put salt on everything because it's so good.
Yeah.
And it's like there's a certain amount of salt that if you eat you die. And it's not even that much. But we go to the Brink every day just because it tastes good.
You know what? And that is my guilty pleasure. I love salt on everything.
Salt tastes good.
I know.
Pork
chops taste good. And apple sauce.
Good. Because our friend Steven that's listening from Village Connection Radio love Pulp Fiction. And I just want to do a quote from Pulp Fiction.
There you go.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. You want another one?
Yeah.
All right. Let me find. Okay. This is just stupidity. Mm-hmm. All right. 24-year-old Philip Quinn in 2004. He's from Kent, Washington. Now, Philip.
Yeah.
He was killed when he was heating his lava lamp on a stove, and it exploded.
What a weirdo.
A piece of shard piercing his heart. Now,
what idiot
puts a lava lamp on a stove? Okay, if anyone's done that, please don't be offended. But what idiot does that?
I don't know why you'd put it on the stove. Like the plug didn't work, so he said he wanted to see the things move, the pretty colors.
Or maybe it wasn't happening fast enough. You know how they have to heat up?
Yeah, he couldn't wait.
Philip needed some patience, I think.
So it exploded and pierced his throat.
His heart! A piece of the glass went boom right into his heart.
I can't. That's exactly what I'm talking about.
Boiled again.
I got two little tiny short ones here that we have about a minute left.
Okay.
Do you know that the Jack Daniels guy? I don't know if this is true or not. Do you have that one?
Yeah. I tell it. It is. That's crazy.
The guy that I guess invented Jack Daniels whiskey died after an infection sustained after kicking a safe and busting his toe.
Sorry, Jack, what were you doing? What went with me? You got so mad about something. You kicked your toe and you died.
And if I had he has a safe.
Good. Wow.
I don't know why I said that, Jennifer.
Because the safe, man. The safe.
Wow.
I wonder what was wrong. Why the safe made him so mad.
Oh, why is it called safe if it's so dangerous?
If it's so dangerous.
Okay, well, thank goodness for everybody because we are at a time break.
Oh, my goodness. Wow.
You're listening to Bizarre Deaths on the Haunted Chronicles. We'll be right back after this song by Cliff Richard. Happy birthday. Welcome back to the Haunted Chronicles home of your guaranteed halftime shout out. And I see a bunch of you listening on multiple pages. I'm going to try to get to everybody. So I see Damien, Nancy. I see Liz from Old Oakenbucket Road, I think. Gretel, Laura, William, Rick, Steve Miller from Village Connection Radio. Indy, Dwayne, Debbie. Let's see. Over on this page here, we got Smog, William, Michael, Kim, Brian, Stacy, holy mackerels, And I didn't even get to the chat yet. In the chat, we have Dr. Dave, LC, Desi, Heidi G, Squatchy, Deborah, Andy Duane, Kara E, Cheryl, Moon Maven, Nan, and Rick from Electric City Paranormal is listening. Our friend Chris is listening. And more. Thank you. I missed everybody, but I did my best. Okay. Jennifer.
Jimmy.
Do you have any more tragic deaths to share with everyone?
Oh, I do.
I do.
Okay. You ready for this one? This is George Herbert, 5th Earl of Carnarvon.
Oh.
Because, you know,
they
he's an Earl.
Earl, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, who financed Howard Carter's search for the King Tut, died after a mosquito bite, which he had cut while shaving, and it became infected.
Oh.
Some attributed his death to the so-called curse of the pharaohs. Now, so you have a mosquito bite, and he's probably on his face, and he shaved his face, and he cut it, and wow.
Do you see a lot of these old historical ones? Like, just people died of simple infections.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Just completely. There was another one. You had... What was the other one that I read? Well, find it. And there was another one that was really similar. Well, the kicking of the safe, by Jack. And then
by
there was
Jack
another
Daniel.
One. If I find it, well, you know, I'll share it. But, yeah, crazy, right?
This isn't a tragic death, but when I was researching the stories, I found like some stats on strange ways people die that you might not know how not popular, but how. Listen to this. The CDC, the Center for Disease Control, they keep records detailing how Americans die. It's morbid but fascinating. The top killers, you know, cancer, heart disease, et cetera, or, you know, up there. But then you go deeper into the list and find that there's a lot of people that die by these weird, strange ways.
Right.
All right. This is the death toll between, I'm going to have you guess at one and then I'll just go on. Just
okay.
The death toll between 1999 and 2014. So you might think they're rare, but. Okay. How many people do you think died in those years? With falls involving ice skates, skis, roller skates, or skateboards. They put that into a category.
Oh, do you want a number?
Yeah, and that 15-year period.
Oh, gosh. That's like so vast to me.
I know it's hard to guess, but just for fun.
Okay, let's say in 15 years, 2,000.
Very good. 1,139 people died from ice skating or roller skating type incidents.
Wow, in 15 years.
15 years. So I got some other stuff here, like a fall from a tree. 1,400.
Oh!
People are falling from trees all over the place. And this one shocked me.
Uh-huh.
Constipation. 2,167 people. From belly aches.
What? Okay.
Yeah. Oh, well, and this.
Yeah, I'm just so confused. Isn't there solutions
I
for
get,
some?
You know, maybe they got a little blocked in or something. They got some infections or going on in there.
Oh, yeah.
And this one, how many people do you think are having accidents with agricultural machinery?
Oh, well, I think that happens a lot more than we think. Let's say 3,000.
I just got disconnected.
Oh, no.
Okay, good. No, my headset fell off for a second.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Yeah, I'm sorry. What did you say?
I just said, threw it out there, 3,000.
Very good guess. Very good. 4,183 deaths from agricultural machinery.
Wow. Wow.
And this one, I didn't research any deeper because I'm lazy. But the category that they made this category for anything to do with falling, suffocation, or accidental strangulation involving a bed.
A bed?
So like falling out of a bed. I don't know how you accidentally suffocate. I don't know with a strangulation involving a bed.
Wow. Okay. I just can't even fathom 1,500. I don't know.
20,600.
What?
Yeah.
What?
So
God, beds are dangerous.
Yeah, actually, I'm getting scared of everything. Don't go roller skating. It's like your grandmother. Don't go roller skating. Don't get constipated. Don't try the farm tractor.
And don't get in your bed at night.
That's what I sleep on the floor with no trees around.
Lord, and no pillows, for God's sake.
No pillows. No black pigs.
Nothing.
No sheep. Nothing.
Okay. I found the other one. I have to, you know, when we were talking about how cuts and all these, you know, little things now that, you know, would be very unusual for anyone to die from. But on July 1st in 1884, Alan Pinkerton. you know Alan. He's the founer of the Pinkerton Detective Agency in Chicago. Remember him?
Somebody posted a picture of, I think it's Judy Garland driving a tractor laughing down a pathway. I'm sorry. I keep laughing.
Oh, my God. You guys are so funny out there. I love you all. Okay, so Alan, our Pinkerton. Favorite, you know, our favorite little dick, right?
Ooh.
He is in Chicago, Illinois, a dick is a detective.
Oh.
Come on now. You know that. Come on. When he tripped on the pavement. Are you ready for this?
Yeah.
Al severely bit his tongue.
Poor Alan Pinkerton.
Yeah. And Alan's tongue became infected with gangrene, ultimately leading to his death.
And this is, it's a famous detective.
Yes, from the Pinkerton Detective Agency.
So don't walk down sidewalks either, people. We're trying to we're trying to help people also.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure.
I'm looking for
I got one. Well, I have another injury you look.
Yeah.
Jean-Baptiste Lully. The French composer. Listen to me trying to be French. Died of a gangrenous abscess after accidentally piercing his foot with a staff while he was vigorously conducting a Te Deum. It was customary at that time to conduct by banging a staff on the floor. So here's the conductor, and they would bang it on the floor instead of, you know, the little thing up high. You know? And he stabs himself, and poor Adolf didn't make it.
You know, this reminds me of Faces of Death, the movie, because, like, everything I look at now is a potential death hazard.
Yeah.
This one, you said you want me to do. Wait, you know what? I want to show you that I listen.
Yeah.
You were trying to be French before.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
When last time we did Sergio Valente jeans, you were telling us about a pair of jeans that you were so excited to get when you were a teenager.
Oh, I had the Chemin de Fer jeans.
Yeah, what was it called?
Chemin de Fer. I had the French jeans. They were really, like, popular, like, in 1974, 5, 6.
You spoke French! Yeah.
And they were so popular, and all I wanted was a pair of Chemin de Fer jeans, and I saved my pennies, and by golly, I got those jeans. There you go.
You got them.
I got them. I scraped and saved and returned Coke bottles and whatever.
I think I told you guys the story about my jeans story when I was a kid, right? With the shiny buttons on them.
Wait, tell me again. Yes.
For new listeners, when I was a kid, all my friends in school had Levi's.
Yeah.
And I had Tough Skins from Sears.
Yes.
And it was so sad. Because I didn't even know where they sold Levi's. You know what I mean? I didn't even know.
Uh-huh.
So my 13th birthday or something, I said, you know, I said, I want Levi's. I told everybody I want Levi's.
Apparently, yeah.
My grandmother, bless her little heart, she thought Levi's was just a generic name for jeans, I think. You know, she didn't know it was a brand I needed, you know. So she got me these jeans with these big gold, it was like disco days, I guess. There's these big gold studs all over the back pocket. And they were big. They were like almost the size of a penny. Shiny, raised gold. And I didn't want to wear them, you know. My mother said, you better wear those jeans.
Oh, no.
So I went to the bus stop. I said, people are going to beat me up over these.
Oh, Jim, I would have taken an extra pair in your school bag.
They beat me up.
Change behind a bush or something. Oh, honey, no. They did not. Did they? Oh, kids are awful.
They're terrible. So I remember I was at the bus stop. That's a true story. I was at the bus stop, and I was, like, sitting in the gravel, in the dirt.
Yeah.
Kind of trying to scuff them so they weren't so shiny.
Man. Like, oh, man.
It was so sad.
Okay, how did you wear them? Did you wear them out? Like, did your mom make you wear them all the time?
I just remember that school incident.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Isn't that just unfortunate when those things happen to us? Ugh.
But now I enjoy it. It made me who I am today.
Yes, that's what I always say, right? All our little idiosyncrasies we went through, all our bullying, Jimmy,
We'll have a whole show about that one day.
Oh, yeah, we should.
And I missed our friends, Sunny, Nicole, and Ro. Okay, sorry.
Okay. Oh, good. Good, you got them.
So, okay. This made me laugh that you wanted to tell. So this is way back. There was some philosopher. I guess some people just walked around being philosophers.
Yeah, like, I guess you could just say you were.
Yeah. So this Greek philosopher, I don't know if it's Chrysippus or something, he is said to have died of laughter. And you know what? This makes me laugh, and I don't know why. He was drunk. And he was watching a donkey eating fish. Also, he was drunk, and his donkey was drunk, and the donkey was trying to eat the figs.
He was trying to eat figs?
Yeah. And he thought it was so funny.
Uh-huh.
And he said something like, now give the donkey a drink of pure wine to wash down the figs. And then maybe back then it was really, really funny. And he thought it was so funny he died during a fit of laughter.
What, did he must have just had a heart attack?
Yeah, he just kept laughing. He's watching the donkey eat figs.
Lord.
A lot of fig stories.
A lot of fig stories, huh?
Multiple fig stories I had that I picked one.
Yeah. Well, we all know the American playwright Tennessee Williams.
I do know.
And, yes, very famous playwright. And he died after accidentally choking. I did not know this. On a plastic bottle cap, which he was using to ingest barbiturates. Reports at the time of his death indicated he had died applying eye drops while holding the cap between his teeth. But this was corrected in the official medical examiner's report 6 months later. Wow. Choke on a bottle cap. That's sad.
You know, this is a very educational show when you think about it, because we learn a lot of stuff just researching.
A lot of history. A lot of history. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did you ever hear of... Did you ever hear the story about King Adolf Frederick?
No, please tell me about Adolf Frederick.
Now, as soon as I hear Adolf Frederick, it reminds me of the story about the squirrel we did a few weeks ago. Remember they named him something Frederick? The little German squirrel.
Yes.
So, ooh, you know what I wanted to mention this week? I'm telling you people, maybe one day over winter I could do it when I'm isn't so busy. I want to put some of these shows on YouTube. So you guys could access them, because they're only the last 20 or 25 on the Paramania site. But remember the Disney episode we did?
Yes.
We called it The Happiest Place to Be, and it was all about Disney deaths and accidents. And we laughed.
We're terrible. Okay, we're terrible. But this is that uncomfortable laughter. You know, this is that laughter that...
We're trying to help.
We're trying to educate. To not do some of these things. Help me here, Jimmy, right?
Right.
Yeah.
So this King Adolf guy, he was a king of Sweden, apparently, and he suffered fatal digestion problems after, listen to this pig, after he ate caviar, sauerkraut, smoked herring, lobster, champagne, and 14 servings of his favorite dessert. And then...
What was his favorite dessert?
I don't know, but it was served in a bowl of hot milk also. Now,
wait, I'm going to see if I can find this.
It's King Adolf Frederick of Sweden. And I remember my mother, if I did that, she goes, Jimmy here, eating like a glutton.
And that, literally, right?
And if Freaky B's going to listen to this and tell my mother that she said that, and she'll say, I never said that, but where would I get that from?
Right.
Eating like a glutton.
You're glutton for punishment. Okay, it was semla. The dessert, 14 servings of semla. And semla, I know what that is. Semla is like
how do you spell it?
It's S-E-M-L-A. It's like a pastry with cream in it.
Yeah, that sounds good.
So he had 14 servings of that. And each serving was in a bowl of hot milk. So, wow.
What a, you know, he deserved it.
Well, yeah, maybe. Okay, all right.
And Sir Max just joined us. How about Sir
Max?
Okay, this one I wanted to get to. This one, I think it might be a revisit from a previous episode a long time ago, because it kind of rings a bell. Poor little Joe D'Souza of Brazil. He was lying in bed with his wife, la di da da, just, you know. And then a freaking cow fell through his roof. It's believed that the cow escaped to a nearby farm, climbed onto the roof, which was like a corrugated one, I guess, not so fancy, and gave way, and the 1.5-ton animal landed on poor Joe.
Mm.
Rescuers took Mr. D'Souza to the hospital with a fractured leg, but no other obvious injuries, and he was talking and conscious and everything, and then hours later, dead from internal bleeding. And his mother said to the news channel, this is her actual quote, and I'll do a reenactment like I do. This is how I imagine her talking. I didn't bring my son up to be killed by a falling cow. Imagine when the cow got back to the farm and he tells his friends, like, he's laughing.
I just took out the farmer, man.
I escaped the farm, jumped on the roof, and killed the guy.
Oh, Lord. Like now, that's bizarre.
It is.
That's bizarre. Okay. Now, I don't know if any of you guys have ever heard of a dancer named Isadora Duncan. Now, this story, my mother told me this story when I think I had to have been 8 years old. And we had, my mom had a little convertible Mustang at the time and loved it when it was summer and, you know, of course, top down and we're in the car one day and I got a scarf around my neck, you know, because it was not that warm. It wasn't that cold either. And my mom was like, make sure you wrap that really good around your neck. And I'm like, okay. And she goes, I had a little piece that was kind of like flapping. And she goes, no, you got to tuck. And she tucked it in. And she goes, you don't know this story, but I'm going to tell you about Isadora Duncan. And she proceeds to tell me how Isadora Duncan, I'm like 8 or 9. I don't know what I was, but young, how she was in her convertible and she always had her signature scarf. And the scarf is, she's driving, the scarf is blowing and it got caught. And the back wheel axle, and it freaking broke her neck. Now, this story, my mother had a way of doing things like this to me. This is one of those stories that haunted me forever.
Yeah.
So, yes, in September of 1927, Isadora Duncan died.
Poor Isabella. You know, you know, your mother did radio with your dad.
Yes.
And do you, imagine if you told her, if you knew the future somehow, and you said, Mom, you're going to come up in a story that I'm going to tell in the Haunted Chronicles about tragic deaths in 2018.
Yeah.
You bet $1 million, that's not going to happen.
No. Right?
And I bet. Mm-hmm. Do you ever hear, I don't know which, can I tell you quick about the death by dwarf?
You know, yeah.
Sometimes I tell you stories about midgets and you get upset at my wording sometimes.
Well, I just know they like to be called little people.
Well,
So you go ahead, Jim. You go for it.
okay, well, it was a regular day back in September 10th of 1197.
Oh.
The year of our Lord, 1197. And Count Henry of Champagne, he was 31 years old. He was a land-owning noble, politician, a great warrior, wealthy, had a beautiful wife. And so the story goes that Henry was leaning near the window of a balcony. Uh-huh. And he turned to greet his dwarf. Now, like, back then, you know, I guess this helped. They had dwarfs that were their advisors and assistants and stuff. This kind of hung around.
Uh-huh.
So this was a male dwarf. His name was Scarlet. Scarlet the dwarf. And the balcony gave way, and Henry began to fall, and little Scarlet grabbed Henry's sleeve. And there's some confusion whether he was trying to, you know, the little dwarf was trying to pull him back over, or he actually tried to push him off, like it was an assassination.
Oh.
But Henry fell, and it wasn't that far. You know, he might not have died from the fall, but they said because little Scarlet the dwarf fell on top of him, they believe that was the cause of his death.
Oh, death? Scarlet was trying to help him.
By dwarf.
Death by dwarf. I think Scarlet was trying to help him.
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because he wouldn't have grabbed for him if he wasn't going to help him.
We probably have time for like a one or two more. You got one? Or?
I could do one.
Go ahead.
All right. I have got, let me see. Oh, I think we all have heard about this one. I'm going to just do this really quick. This was actually 2018. Oh. Elaine Hertzberg. This is bizarre, and I hope, anyway. 49-year-old woman in Tempe, Arizona, died after being hit by a self-driving car operated by Uber as she crossed the road. And what was reported to be the first death of a pedestrian struck by a self-driving car on public roads. Of course, in response to the fatal accident, Uber suspended self-driving tests in all U.S. cities. Now, are they doing this in other countries?
I don't know.
Uber thing? I'm just wondering. I don't think anything self-driving is... That doesn't sound too good to me.
No, they're not ready for that yet.
I don't think.
Ugh. Oh, my God. Listen, Jennifer.
Honey, what?
We're not going to be back till after Halloween.
Oh, my gosh. We're so busy lately, and I. I know.
So we'll be back after Halloween for some new shows.
Yes. And God bless all of our deaths tonight. Yes, God bless them. You know, we didn't. Yeah.
Good night, chatters.
Good
Thank
night,
you.
Everybody.
Good night, Jennifer.
Good night, Jim.